This is one of 10 15-minute programs entitled Catholic Questions and Answers. They will be dealing with domestic Catholic problems, primarily on faith and morals. Answering these questions will be Father Doug Nohava of the New Covenant Newman Center at Phoenix College. First question is, what is the basis for the Catholic teaching on confessing to a priest in the case of serious sin?
Jay, too often when Catholics and other Christians discuss this point, there is an exchange of interpretations of scripture passages which ignores the most important biblical insight in this matter. The basic truth taught to us by Jesus in this matter is that salvation comes through the church, through taking one's place in the community of believers, through witnessing to the resurrection of Jesus by what we say and do. This concept, further developed by St. Paul in terms of the body of Christ in Romans 12, teaches us that sin and forgiveness are not private matters between the Christian and the Heavenly Father. We continue the saving work of Jesus by sharing the gifts and fruits of the Spirit, by building up the body of Christ. And when we sin, we act against the living church. We deny our place in the body of Christ. We sin against our brothers and sisters who have accepted the challenge of Jesus to live and preach the gospel. We betray them as well as betraying the lordship of Jesus. Of all the texts of Scripture, the teaching on the body of Christ is an open door in the Bible to a deep understanding of the sacrament of confession, of confessing to a priest, as it is known today in the Catholic Church, reconciliation.
Father, how does the Catholic Church face the objection raised by other Christians that they don't need to go to a priest, that they can go directly to God?
This misunderstanding is based on an incorrect image of the priest as a middleman or go-between. This image is rightly rejected by other Christians and should even be rejected by Catholics if it carries with it the idea that Catholics cannot go directly to God or that Catholics cannot get to God for forgiveness except through the priest. What is the true role of the priest in the Catholic teaching? It is this, that he, joined with the bishop, presides over the Catholic Christian people, proclaiming the gospel, ordering the gifts of the Spirit found among the people, and leading them in praising the Heavenly Father in the Eucharist, the Mass. Since, by his spiritual gift, he is a living sign of the local church, when the priest takes part in the sacrament of reconciliation with the sinner, he does so as a living sign of the body of Christ. Therefore, the priest is not to be seen just as a middleman, as someone higher up the ladder that God will listen to better, or as a magic man without whom there is no forgiveness. Instead, the priest is the living sign of the living church. When a sinner wishes to repent of his or her sin and return to living as a member of the body of Christ, the body of Christ is made present through its leader, the priest. This is made very clear as the priest pronounces the absolution for the person who repents of their sin. He says, God, the Father of mercies, through the death and resurrection of his Son, has reconciled the world to himself and sent the Holy Spirit among us for the forgiveness of sins. Through the ministry of the church, may God give you pardon and peace, and I absolve you from your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. The priest, speaking in the name of the living church, filled with the power of the Holy Spirit, receives the renewed commitment of the member of the body of Christ. He does so with the authority of Jesus, speaking our faith that sin is forgiven when we repent and when we forgive those who sin against us. We should remember that the primary value of confession or reconciliation with the priest is not for the counseling or because he is closer to God, but because he is the living sign of the living church, able to speak in the name of the church and in the name of Jesus, the Lord of the church, that the sinner is forgiven and welcomed back.
Do Catholics still use a confession box to make their confession in?
Jay, since the renewal of this sacrament, the church has tried to make the usual place where the sacrament of reconciliation is received a place of peace and prayer. Although a person's confession can be heard any place in the case of necessity, the right atmosphere helps us to pray better. The best atmosphere is to be in the presence of the living God and a gentle priest. The physical surroundings can only add to that. In reconciliation rooms, as they are often called, there is to be room for the person to pray with the priest face to face, or to pray and make their confession with a screen between them, if the person wishes to remain anonymous. There should also be a picture of the Lord, perhaps a crucifix, a Bible, other reminders of our faith. The choice of the person making the confession as to whether they wish to go face to face to the priest or with the screen in between them is to be left to the person making the confession so that they will be comfortable.
Father, how often do Catholics have to go to confession to a priest?
As part of their sacramental life, Catholics are encouraged to make use of this sacrament. However, the minimum required for Catholics is that they celebrate the sacrament once a year if they have committed serious sin. Obviously, a person who has been sincerely trying to live as a member of the body of Christ cannot and should not be required to make use of this sacramental gift of reconciliation, since they have never rejected their role as a Christian. For such a person, the Mass itself is a major sign and place and time of renewal of their commitment, and the gift of confession or reconciliation is best celebrated with a priest who can also give counsel and spiritual guidance for continued growth and deepening of the faith.
Why did the Catholic Church bother changing the name of the sacrament of confession to penance and then finally to reconciliation?
The name was changed, Jay, to encourage a change in the thinking of the people. In the same way, the name of the sacrament of extreme unction, or the last anointing, was changed to the sacrament of the sick, to help the people understand that the sacrament of the sick does not have to be given only at the time of death, but is to be used when there is serious sickness. With regard to reconciliation, the new name means to be restored to a peaceful and honest relationship, both with God and with His Church. The name confession focused most directly on the telling of the sins to the priest, not on making peace with God and the Church. Many older Catholics will tell you that as a result, they concentrated on making sure that they had remembered every sin, and sometimes even added a few extra just in case they'd forgotten any. And this was not good. It led to a listing of sins, more than getting down to what the root causes of the sin were and which relationships were injured. The new name, reconciliation, teaches us to focus on the root causes of sin in our life and the relationships both with the Lord and with others which need repairing. The other name, which was sometimes used, was penance. Although this name has a good meaning, it is confused by some people with the action or prayer which the priest may ask the person confessing to pray or perform in order to begin to right the wrongs that were done and to heal the relationships. Our Christian brothers and sisters should clearly understand that this penance is not seen by the Catholic Church as payment to God in exchange for forgiveness. Rather, it is seen as the beginning of the spiritual healing process, in which the person who was under the burden of sin is directed in the first steps toward a deeper life with Jesus. Although the Catholic is not taught to pay God back, the Catholic is taught in reconciliation to take his or her part in building up the body of Christ by praying and working for the right relationships that were ruined by their own sin.
Father, does the Catholic doctrine of purgatory fit in here?
Yes, Jay. It is in the context of sin and being healed of the effects of sin that the Catholic doctrine of purgatory is best understood. First, let me say what purgatory is not. It is not a third place or state of being between salvation and damnation. It is salvation. The name purgatory comes from the word purge, to be cleansed. To use a very human comparison, a child very much loved by his parents is called to the supper table. When the child comes, he is dirty from playing, his clothes are messy, and there are scrapes and scratches. Perhaps there was quarreling with a brother or sister. The parent, the one who loves the child very much and who does not reject the child for all these things, will still wash the child, tend the scratches, change the clothes, and have the child make peace with the brother or sister before bringing the child to the table. Even though this is a very human comparison, it may help to make clear the love that the Heavenly Father has for us as Catholics see it. God has accepted and forgiven us as brothers and sisters of his only Son, Jesus, and he does not choose to reject us. And yet, when we come into his presence at death, if we need further cleansing and healing or reconciling, he tends to that, so that we might come to see him face to face.
Father, is the teaching of purgatory in the scriptures?
The doctrine of being cleansed and healed by the loving God is definitely in the scriptures. The knowledge that this can take place after death is part of the living tradition of the church. There is mention in the second book of Maccabees, chapter 12, verses 38 through 45. Since this book is one of those considered canonical by the Catholic Church, and as deuterocanonical by many others, many of our Christian brothers and sisters may not know this passage. Let me read it for you. This is from the second book of Maccabees, chapter 12. Judas Maccabeus then rallied his army and moved on to the town of Adullam, and since the seventh day of the week had arrived, they purified themselves according to custom and kept the Sabbath in that place. The next day they came to Judas to have the bodies of the fallen taken up and laid to rest among their relatives in the ancestral tombs. But when they found on each of the dead men, under their tunics, amulets of the idols taken from Jamnia, which the law prohibits to Jews, it became clear to everyone that this was why these men had lost their lives. All then blessed the ways of the Lord, the just judge who brings hidden things to light, and gave themselves to prayer, begging that the sin committed might be fully blotted out. Next, the valiant Judas urged the people to keep themselves free from all sin, having seen with their own eyes the effects of the sin of those who had fallen. After this, he took a collection from them individually, amounting to nearly 2,000 drachmae, and sent it to Jerusalem to have a sacrifice for sin offered. An altogether fine and noble action, in which he took full account of the resurrection. For if he had not expected the fallen to rise again, it would have been superfluous and foolish to pray for the dead. Whereas if he had in view the splendid recompense reserved for those who make a pious end, the thought was holy and devout. This is why he had this atonement sacrifice offered for the dead, so that they might be released from their sin. So, Jay, once again, Christians who refuse the gift of the Catholic books of the Scripture will not find these words of faith in their Bible. And yet, for Catholics, this tradition of purgatory is both in the Scripture and in the constant living tradition of the Church.
How is purgatory different from reincarnation?
In the faith doctrine of purgatory proclaimed by the Catholic Church, God has given his people an understanding that there is a way to needed growth and healing after death, without having to come back to earth in some other form or body, which is what reincarnation means. Thus, Catholics believe in life in the flesh, we believe in death, and we believe in continued life after death, including the cleansing and growth of purgatory if it is needed. In the words of the ancient Nicene Creed, we believe in the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. We hope these questions and answers on confession, reconciliation, and purgatory will help both our Catholic and other Christian brothers and sisters to understand us even better. May God bless each one of you.
You have been listening to Father Doug Nohava of the New Covenant Newman Center at Phoenix College. For any comments or criticisms, please write to Father Doug, 2911 North 11th Avenue, Phoenix, Arizona. The zip code is 85013. Write to Father Doug, 2911 North 11th Avenue, Phoenix, Arizona, zip code 85013. He'll be waiting to hear from you soon. God bless you and good day.